Dear audience, most welcome to this session. First, I would like just to be grateful and say thank you to our host, the Bertelsmann Foundation, who made this possible for us to host this session and providing this opportunity for all of you also to discuss what I think is a crucial issue, a crucial point in better regulation work. It's, you can say, if you want to make it easy, how to get happy companies in this. I think a lot of people talk about the companies are always complaining, is anything working? We are working hard with our better regulation work in the government, but they don't feel it. So this session will actually not talk so much about the problems. We will talk about some systems and some things that are working, actually. So we will talk about what does business want and from regulatory reform, and is it making a difference? You will hear a few words about that today, and hopefully you can take it with you in your own work at home. So we will be focusing on the types of change and also look at reforms that make difference for companies. But before I start, I, of course, will start to introduce my panel, and I'm very happy about them. We have one representative from Sweden, one from Denmark, and one from UK. And on my right, I have Annika Fritz. She is a tax and corporate law specialist at the Swedish Federation of Private Enterprise, and also member of the Stoiber Group, also coordinating the work in Sweden for better regulation. And then the second on my right is Jesper Fries from Confederation of Danish Industry. And he is replacing Thomas Møller Sørensen. He couldn't come today, but I know Jesper is well equipped with information regarding better regulation in Denmark. And most welcome also. He's also a member of the Working Group for Business Europe in Brussels for better regulation. And on my left, Mr. Ed Humphreyson from the UK National Audit Office. And he's not from business, but we think it's very good to have him here because he's from one of the bodies that are actually engaged in assessing the results of better regulation work. He's doing a great job in UK, looking to the toolbox and into the tools and saying what kind of measures are actually working. So we will hear about more about that, and thank you for coming. And I will invite the speakers to share their views soon. I just wanted to say that afterwards we have question time. We have microphones in the middle and on the left side over there. And you can post questions to the speakers after they have made their presentations, all of them. And I hope that we also can have some discussion there on this topic and afterwards as well. But before I give the floor to the speakers, I just wanted to present my organization. Could you please take the next slides? No. Thank you. And my organization is quite unique, I believe. We are an umbrella organization for business organizations. So we are founded in 1982, and it's actually financed by the business organization in Sweden. The 15 main ones are the ones that are financing this, and also they have branch sectors, so we altogether close to 100 business organizations. So most of the companies that are active in Sweden are members in our organization. And it's also due to an ordinance that if the state agencies or the government would like to go out regarding reporting burden, they actually have to consult my organization, and we look into the forms and things like that before they go out. And our role is, of course, to work to minimize the workload for companies. And, of course, we work with regulatory impact assessments. We look into all the new regulations, both on governmental level as well as state agency level. And it's about 300 a year. So we look at effects for companies. That's our specialty. And we are doing that very close together with our member federation in different sectors. And we also act as an advisor to the Swedish government in the ongoing better regulation project. And we will come back to that later on. But what I would like to stress in this scenario is that what business really want is an easy system, understandable and easy to comply with. And of course, I know it's very hard to find this solution, but one way is looking at different alternatives, finding a new regulation. And in that case, we are also looking into not just the existing regulation, but also the flow of new and amended regulation as well. This session, we know that regulations are a major concerns of business. And we also need regulations, of course. But what we have realized now, and that's why we have this session, that we have realized that regulations are too time-consuming and actually too costly for business to be competitive. And you can see all over Europe and in many countries around the world talk about better regulation, and that's why we have this session. We think it's time to stop now and also to look what kind of measures are actually working. And just to stress that we are not just looking at the new regulations, and we will look also at the existing stock of regulations. I think it's very important that you work with both hands here to get better regulation. In an experience I had a few years ago, when we had the better regulation work going on, just looking into the existing regulation, they made quite a good job and reducing some regulation, taking away costs. But the flow of new regulation took their place in just a few years. So we were back on the same spot again. So it's very important to do both. I will end to say something about impact assessment. We have been doing some research on that, and we have also seen that in Europe and many other places, that it's the impact assessments are getting better, but they're due to, from business point of view, and I think everybody could say that, the quality could be better. And one thing that we realized, and reform actually, who made it better, was to introduce oversight scrutiny body, like you have in the Dutch system with ACTAL, and you have a Norman Kontrollrat in Germany, and in Sweden, we actually will have one in a few weeks as well. Just to say that we will have a regulatory council made the regulations better. And now soon we will have the regulation council, and they could follow up that more precise year from year. But I think that's type of system changes that are important for business to see that the someone is looking at the impact assessment before the decision is made, so to get the best possible alternative. And now is high time to let over the time for Annika Fritz, and she will talk about the experiences from Sweden. Please, Annika.
Thank you. Can we have the next set of slides, please? Thank you. And the next picture also. I can make sure. Let me first introduce myself and my organization for a little bit. The Swedish Federation of Private Enterprises, or Företagarna, as we are called in Sweden, is the largest SME organization. It was founded about 100 years ago, and it represents today about 70,000 businessmen and women in all types of privately owned companies. And this includes also 16 sectorial associations, and we are then a member of NNR. And we are highly committed to the work of better regulations, and what I would like to do now in my panel speech here is to talk a little bit about key concepts that can work and that can still be improved, and from a national point of view in this session. The Swedish government set a rather ambitious goal. Its target is 25% reduction by 2010, and it is a net reduction, which is very much more ambitious than at the EU level, because that is not definitely pronounced as a net target anyhow. So this calls for great actions, of course. And some of the key issues for that is that there has to be communication between the government as a driving force for better regulations, but also with the business organizations, so that we are able to really put forward what is the problem for the companies, for the smaller ones in my perspective, and what could be improved. Because it's not easy for the little tradesman to say, they cannot pinpoint, definitely not the directive and not even the national legislative act which causes the problem. They can pinpoint at large the concept of auditing is a problem, or the concept of taxes is a problem. So in order to get a little bit more focus on what was the problem for the Swedish companies, we made a questionnaire to our members about a year ago. And we had about 3,000 answers to that, and it showed actually what are the top irritants of the companies. These were quite open questions, so we didn't direct them which of the following are the most burdensome or the most annoying to you. These are really what they said themselves. And there were labor market rules, audit matters, and information obligations to various agencies that were at the top, along with VAT regulations. But this is the basis for what we have then proposed together with other business organizations in Sweden. We have submitted over 400 simplification proposals to the Swedish government, based, in our case, on the results of the questionnaire. And of course, we still have some concerns about the pace of regulatory reform in Sweden, but we are pleased that several of our suggestions have been already implemented and others are well on the way. One successful example of burden reduction is there, where my organization has been involved, is the change for small business in the monthly report for VAT. Now it comes down to a quarterly report instead, which of course means less work for the small business. And that's quite a simple method of reducing the regulatory burden by reducing the frequency of reporting obligation. And we also welcome a pending proposal in Sweden to abolish the mandatory audit of annual accounts for small liability companies. I know most of the member states of the EU have already implemented such an exemption for the small companies. Sweden has not, but now we have a government proposal to do so. Or at least the inquiry has stated that. We're still waiting for the government proposal to be put to the parliament, but we believe it will come. And we see that as a very positive step, because we don't feel that the member states should have any, we should avoid gold plating and over implementing of the directives. We also commend the Swedish government for its initiative to establish a central register of all reporting obligations on business. It's inspired by the Norwegian model of Brønnøysund register, which means that there should be no duplication of the reporting requirements. Only once should be the guideline, and that would make a huge difference. The current burden of reporting for business involves 90 government agencies and around 94 million forms every year. So we could put great hope in this central register of reporting obligations, especially regarding statistics, as that area is not very well adapted to the business environment. It's not the same information obligation that you present in other areas, so it involves a lot more work. And speaking of the workload, it's also a question of there is still some regulatory inflation, which you also mentioned, Jens, that along with what we believe that there should be a reduction, still it pops up increases. And one way to solve this would, of course, be to introduce a ceiling for the administrative burden so that any increase in the administrative burden would have to be matched by a reduction in another area. Then you would have to argue very much before you hit the ceiling and go through it in one area. And still, this would be one way of turning the burden into a reduction. So government has to be the driving force, but we also, as business organizations, must commit ourselves to present proposals in a very concrete way, because we know how business works. We have a lot of contact with our members, and we know when changes are needed. We have also, so we believe that these are the guidelines that should be for the better regulations. Think small first, the only ones, and the ceiling for the administrative costs. Fundamentally, the message is that it should be easy for business to comply with regulations. They should be simple and they should be stable, but also introducing new changes, even though they are simplifications, means a burden, a compliance cost for the companies. So this is essential that you don't shift the rules too much. We also need to put a focus on the total regulatory burden, not only using the administrative costs. The compliance costs are perceived as irritating, burdensome, and costly. They are not only measured in the standard cost model. Keeping up to date with frequent changes is very burdensome. Lack of information on which regulations apply and how they should be applied, and time-consuming search for information and guidance is also burdensome. These aspects must be met, of course, and irritation is also a burden to business, not only the costs in euros or crowns. Research that NNR carried out in 2006 revealed that the administrative costs are a relatively small portion of the total regulatory costs. Financial and material costs are much higher. And this underlines the importance of listening to business organizations and not limiting the focus to reducing the administrative costs. At EU level, we have also cooperated between business organizations in Sweden and with NNR to submit a joint proposal of 27 different proposals to EU, to the Commission. And we have also submitted other proposals in the work of the high-level group on administrative burdens. But we need also to get feedback on the proposals. That is very important. when business organizations and business actually commit themselves and put forward proposals for concrete measures, then it is important to receive feedback on how the government or the Commission is taking this forward. So we are pleased with the consultation process, and it's good that it is a recognized key portion of the better regulation process at national as well as EU level. This is also a long-time commitment, of course. Better regulation is no quick fix, and we must realize that it will not be completed in 2010 or 2012, depending on the target for the 25%. We need a continued commitment, and that is why it's so important that a lot of EU member states have agreed on regulatory reform for the standard cost model. We can understand that there needs to be quantified data, but we also need to focus on what the business really find irritating. And therefore, it's also very necessary to do an evaluation and assess the results, because, of course, we produce proposals and we produce, the government introduces new legislation, and then we hope and we do this with the argument that this will mean better regulation, but we must also see that it actually fills its target, that it actually provides efficient results. So it's very important to make evaluation. And we just the seminar before, we heard that in Australia they have a review after 1 or 2 years for all the better regulation proposals. I would think that would be a very good idea to implement both in the member states and at EU level. Just review how is it really working? Could it be done better? Could it be done more or less? This is a lesson to learn, and we should always learn from our neighbors, and that is very important. So we need to identify what the problems are, and we need to cooperate in doing so between business organizations and governments and agencies, and we need to continue doing so. Thank you.
Thank you, Annika. But before I give the floor to Jesper, I have some questions, just two questions. If we have the tools in Sweden business still complains, you know, they're not, all of them are not happy yet. How do you know that business really know what they want? Could you say something about that? Is this just the latest irritation that are the problem, or could you just comment on that? And then as a member of the Stoiber group, I would like to know, and perhaps some other people around here, how you are working with the toolbox like impact assessment and measurement.
Okay. First, is it still just the latest irritant? I don't believe it is. We have substantial contact with our members, and we can, judging from both our questionnaire and the frequent contacts, we have advice for them, and they, of course, if it's a very burdensome information obligation, then we have a lot of problems with it, and we can say that it is quite consistent over time what they are complaining about, and it is very much labor market rules and taxes, of course, and this is auditing, of course, but so this is one thing I know the Swedish business or Swedish limited liability companies are looking forward to, not having the obligation to have an audit. Depending on their stakeholders, they will possibly, a lot of them will continue to have auditing, but it's not a mandatory it's not regulated by the Swedish government, that all Swedish limited liability companies must have the same audit. They can demand different auditing, they can demand different quality checks for their annual accounts and so on. And of course, business don't feel the need for the 25% reduction. If they cannot feel it in their everyday life, then there's no benefit to them, or they don't perceive the benefit. So the important thing is that you really manage to communicate to them what are the changes. And of course, we try to do that, and we also try to say, how can we go forward? What is necessary? What is burdensome? And of course, if you lift a burden from them, then they will not say only, oh, we are very happy. They will, of course, there will be others complaining about other burdens. So in that sense, you are correct. the latest still remaining burden will be complained about.
Thank you. And a few words about Stoiber Group.
Okay. The Stoiber Group, or the high-level group of independent stakeholders on administrative burdens. We are 15 members, and we started the work in January 2008. Our mandate runs for 3 years, which means that we will be here while the Commission has gone and while the Parliament has been changed. So, depending on what happens there, we will perhaps have a different agenda. But it's a very challenging work, and we have managed now to present 4 opinions on company law, on fast-track actions, on some of the offline proposals coming in from stakeholders, business or organizations, and also on VAT invoicing. It was last in October. And we will continue, of course, with all the other 13 priority areas, and also we will all give opinions on all the online and offline proposals that the Commission finds should be taken forward, should be considered. The problem is, to a large extent, that the measurements, there is no baseline measurement on the EU level, so it's only measurements in 6 different countries, and then there's an extrapolation from the data in other countries, and they don't really match. So it's not as if you had at national level made a baseline measurement and say this has changed, now we have reduced it. So the quality is a problem as yet, and there are imperfections, especially as we get the draft reports only with at a very early stage, and this is what we have to work with to form our opinion. Also the extreme time pressure, since there is a change of commission during 2009, and Mr. Barroso and Mr. Verheugen, of course, want to achieve very much reduction by then, which from one side it pressures us that we have only as early as possible get the measurement data, and on the other hand, as short a period as possible for us to be working on the opinion before the Commission wants to have the opinion ready. So this is really, this is a problem, but we have to live with it. And one of the problems is that there is no impact assessment at all made on the proposals that we receive in the high-level group. So one must remember that these are raw data. They are proposals made by the consortium. Of course, they are only one, the only ones that the Commission wants to go ahead with, but there is no impact assessment. So somewhere you have to start.
Thank you very much, Annika. And Jesper, Danish industry. Denmark was one of the starters on standard cost model. After we have seen that in the Netherlands, of course, and have you seen any changes?
Well, a little bit. I'll return to that. I see some representatives of the government here as well, so I'll try to be a little nice to them and say that they've done good things. But there still rests a lot of work to do. I'm, as you said, from the Confederation of Danish Industry. We organize 11,000 enterprises in Denmark, some of the largest in Denmark, like Carlsberg, but also a lot of small and medium-sized enterprises. And 80% of our members are small and medium-sized enterprises. And I actually work in a department of small and medium-sized enterprises where we organize our work on better regulation. The question today is, what does business want? Well, it's not that difficult, actually, as I wrote it. They want to do business. And in a better regulation context, that means they don't want the government agencies wasting too much of their time with weird requests for forms or inspections or other rules. But as we all know, we need some sort of regulation. So the only way to handle this problem is to make the regulation very effective and minimize the time used on complying with it. And we spent many years of building this whole regulatory complex, so now we need to dismantle some of the more unfortunate effects. We need to stop forcing business to report the same information several times to different agencies. That's a real annoyance, and it's kind of stupid as well. And we also need to stop making inspections without knowing what we're looking for. The government needs to focus on the places where there are risks. Now, we just went to a seminar on risk-based regulation, and there's still some lessons to be learned there. We also need to stop asking businesses for information they don't even have. Annika named the statistical measurements where the statistics bureaus have some information they want, and they ask the business for them, and they have to make new counts of everything they use. And I think we need to focus more on what information does the enterprises actually have from the everyday work, and how can we use them. And lastly, and most importantly, we need to stop making regulation from the perspective of government agencies and start making it from the perspective of what happens in the enterprises. How can we focus on their process? And this leads directly. These are directed to some principles for better regulation. And I think Annika named some of the same principles. But as I said here, legislation must be lean and adapted to the everyday routines of the enterprises. Starting to focus on them. The work process should be analyzed so they can be complied with in a logical fashion and not just put together from various pieces of problems, without focusing on how the whole process is managed. As I said, inspections should be risk-based, and finally, e-government should be handled through the principle of one information, one time, one place. It's kind of the same principle that you referred to, Annika. And how well have they done in Denmark in complying with these principles? Well, in 2002, the government set the net target as well, that we should reduce the admin burdens by 25% in 2010. So we are as ambitious as the Swedes. They introduced the standard cost model in 2004, so they had the measurements to handle this obligation. And by 2008, the burdens have been reduced by 10%. So we are moving forward, but there's still a bit of way to go, as you can see, if we are to make it in 2 years. But to myself, I wanted to be positive, but there's a little bit of a criticism in my next slide. Because in managing this process, the government has delegated the responsibility of complying with the 25% reduction to each ministry, and by now I think it's the 7 most burdensome ministries who has to do this. But as you can see, there's a vast difference in the performance. The Ministry of Taxation has been quite good and reduced the burdens by almost 25%, and the Ministry of Economic and Business Affairs are coming along as well. But a lot of the other ministries aren't doing as well. And this shows that even though we're starting to have better regulation embedded in the system and have all the processes in place, there's still a lack of support throughout the system. It's, there's still sectors who are not taking this issue seriously. And we, of course, have to deal with this. It also shows that this effort is not well coordinated, there might be some good effects between the different ministries who are not utilized because not all are working as well on this subject. Because you have to understand from the perspective of an enterprise or a business, they don't really care who are regulating. They just see it as regulation, and it's annoying no matter where it comes from. So therefore, it's really necessary to get away from a sectoral view of regulation to a cooperative view in the government agencies. And this slide illustrates that this might not be quite the case in Denmark yet. But even though this is so, the enterprises have actually experienced some progress. One third of our members, or almost one third, says that to some degree they can see that their everyday life have become easier while the government have done this. I must say there was actually another opportunity in this questionnaire that was very much, but nobody chose to take that one. So that also shows that there might be still some work to do. But we are coming along. I mean, there's actually been some improvements, and actually also something that some of the enterprises at least experience, at least when we're talking to members of DI. I'm not sure if that's true for all of the enterprises. At the end, well, I guess we should ask, what works? What is it that we see really has moved this process along? Well, the standard cost model and, I could also say, impact assessments are essential. We need some measurements, and we need this tool to discipline both politicians and the civil servants for making more regulation. Without measurements, we are lost, and as Jens said, we might just end up with, after we've simplified something, that new regulation pops up, and then what's it worth? But also, the model should be combined closely with the experience of the enterprises, looking at their work processes. And I know that the Ministry of Economic and Business Affairs right now, this autumn, had people out visiting our enterprises and seeing how do they perceive regulation, how can we make it better. And they, of course, need to work closely with us, business organizations, who are very much interested in this. And we have, I think, done some of our part by contributing with a lot of proposals to how this could be done. Targets should be delegated to different authorities to ensure responsibility, to ensure political responsibility. That's what we've done with some success. So they also need to be held politically accountable for not achieving this. And as I said, one information, one time, one place should be the guiding principle. And at the end, regulation should be designed with a logical division of labor. And what do I mean by this? I mean that we need to see what kind of labor is logical to do in the enterprise and what's logical to do in the administration. The administration shouldn't put work out on the enterprise to simplify their own everyday life. We have some unfortunate, I think, example this last couple of years with a new register for income that every enterprise now has to report electronically every month the income of their employees and a lot of other information, and the transition here hasn't been quite successful. This might work well at the end if the different government agencies start to use all the information to relieve other burdens, but so far they haven't done that, and that's a problem. One example, I want to end on a positive note, so I'm going to end up with an example of something that worked really well, and that's a simplification on the reporting of sickness benefits in Denmark, where you really try to design the process as a logical thing and not just make some random simplifications. Before the simplification, every enterprise who were applying for sickness benefits for their employees had to find out which municipality this employee belonged to. They had to send documents to the municipality, and they also had to send a document to the employee who had to sign it and then send it back. This was, of course, very burdensome, and now they made an electronic solution where the enterprise can go to the internet. They don't have to get the signature anymore. The web portal finds the municipality on its own. So here you really start to work intelligently and design the whole process out of new electronic possibilities. And not only made the process electronic, but also simplified the process to make it compatible with this new solution. And I think solutions like this we need to have if we are going to avoid our business owners looking like this. Thank you.
Thank you, Jesper. Looking at this picture here, I thought about, you talked about shared responsibility, division of labor between the ministries and the government, so on, and the agencies, but also the business organization have some responsibility. And now you have seen progress in Denmark, and I know you have done a few things also. Could you just elaborate a little bit about that, what you have done?
As an organization?
Yes.
For helping out, yes. Well, we published several catalogs with proposals we sent to the different ministries to support them in finding the work. I mean, our role is really to be the mediator both between enterprises and government and also the other way around. So we're also trying a lot to inform of the new proposals because or the new simplifications, because as we know that a new possibility isn't worth much if nobody knows it's there. So of course we have a big responsibility in informing our enterprises what the government are actually doing. And the other way around, we have a big responsibility of informing the government what they should do to help our members. So that's our main role, and we found several enterprises who participated in governmental work groups to also make a direct link. And as I said, we of course ourselves are very active and have a close contact, I hope, with our fellows over there.
Thank you very much. Let's go over to Ed now and to hear about National Audit Office. You're working on another arena, but at the same arena, I could say, and you're looking into the tool and the toolbox and if they're working. The floor is yours. Please give you.
Well, thank you very much. It's so much the case that we are working in the same arena as Sweden and Denmark, that many of the points, or almost all of the points that you've heard from the previous two speakers are entirely relevant to the UK, really sort of shockingly so. I could almost have just crossed out the words Denmark and written UK on the previous presentation, and I think it would all pretty much have been consistent, even down to the finding that it's the Ministry of Finance, Tax Revenue, Ministry of Taxation, which has made the most progress. Now, that's a great relief to me to be able to tell you that you've already heard a lot about the United Kingdom through the lens of Sweden and Denmark, because what I'm going to speak about isn't actually grounded in the detail of the UK experience. It's a little bit broader. A few months ago, I read an excellent novel by José Saramago, the Portuguese Nobel Prize winner. His novel is Blindness. It's soon to be a film, I believe. And his novel really deals with inversion. He deals with what happens when our norms and our standards and our codes are inverted, what happens to society. His particular device in the book Blindness is to imagine what would happen if everybody in society, more or less overnight, becomes blind, and how society would cope. And without wishing to give too much of the story away, I'm sure you'll enjoy either the book or the film, things don't go very well when things get inverted. There's a lot of unhappiness, society collapses, the institutions around us seem to be revealed as being quite fragile. Now, I don't think that's too fanciful a way of looking at the world of regulation. After all, if we think of the issue of financial services, this financial crisis we've been living through, it's got an extraordinary degree of inversion embedded within it. We started off, after all, with a situation in which banks, normally the absolute model of thorough due diligence, these banks didn't really gain a proper understanding of their assets. Whether that asset is an underlying mortgage to a homeowner in the United States who wasn't required to give evidence of their income, or at a more rarefied level, whether it's a bank buying a collateralized debt obligation, a CDO, which is underpinned by a lot of flaky, misunderstood assets. So you have an inversion there. Banks don't understand their assets. You get a second inversion then, that flipping over, banks suddenly stop trusting their borrowers. So much so that they no longer even trust the banks who borrow from them. So the interbank market freezes up. This lack of trust has a sort of glacial effect across the whole system, which is why you saw this enormous and, in my experience, quite unprecedented spread between the rate at which a central bank was willing to lend to banks and the rate at which banks were willing to lend to each other's. You then get a ramification of that, which is that depositors no longer trust banks. And of course, the most famous example of this was in the United Kingdom, when the Northern Rock Bank suffered an absolute crisis of confidence with individual depositors withdrawing their money. And finally, as a corollary of all of that, stock markets and investors in general lose their confidence in the whole system. Now, that's a tale where inversions end up with a great deal of sadness. Both in my example of the book Blindness, inverting reality creates sadness, and I think that's also true of our financial system. I want to speak about four ways of inverting our understanding, which I think can lead to happiness. So I want to do some inversion, but with a better result. I think the first inversion that you should be aware of is the National Audit Office, actually. Here I am sharing a platform with representatives of business organizations. And yet, here am I, a public official paid by the taxpayer, speaking about what's good for business. That is pretty much an inversion. People like me do not normally sit on public platforms and talk about what's good for business. And I'd like to explain for a few moments why we think it matters. The first, obviously, is that actually, in this context of administrative burden reduction and regulatory reform, the term business is a proxy. It's not actually purely profit-making entities that we're interested in. It's actually, we use the term business to mean any independent organization which is subject to regulation. So that captures not-for-profit institutions and indeed public sector organizations themselves, which are of course subject to regulation. And I sit on the board of the National Audit Office, and in our board deliberations, from time to time, we have to consider how to implement new regulations which affect us. Particularly, for example, in the labour market sphere. So I'm not without experience of the experience of regulation. But there's another and much more important way in which we as public sector auditors are interested in the business experience. It's because when we look at any goal, any policy, any programme of government, we are always interested in who the intended beneficiaries of that policy or program or project are, the intended beneficiaries, and then we ask, are they benefiting to the extent planned in the original political vision? So therefore, for us, talking about business is not a luxury or a diversion. It's actually core to understanding regulatory reform. It's core to understanding all of these things that we're talking about in this conference. Are they having an impact, the desired impact at the level of the experience of organizations? So that's my first inversion. You've got someone like me talking about business interests. That's unusual. My second inversion is, again, about me as an auditor, and that is that I'm an auditor, and my organization is an audit organization that isn't that interested in the numbers. Now, that's a quite unusual thing for auditors. Normally, I assume your experience of auditors is people who are perhaps excessively or robotically interested in the numbers. And in the case of administrative burdens reduction, there is no shortage of numbers. Just to use the UK numbers, there are 20,000 information obligations imposed on business, which cost, as at May 2005, £31 billion. In terms of the burden imposed, of which £20 billion is what is assumed to be additional, and £11 billion is business as usual, what the business would incur anyway in its ordinary course of operation. So £20 billion of fresh government cost, administrative burden. That's the target. The target is to cut that by another number, 25%. So really, this ought to be fertile territory for an auditor. There's lots of things that we can pick over. And we have actually, yes, done some of the important work to get behind some of these numbers, particularly where departments are now claiming that they've put in place a measure which then reduces the burden. They take £50 million out by this measure, or they reduce the burden by £20 million by another measure. We have done the sort of work that you'd expect us to do. But that's really not what we're interested in. There's a degree of spurious accuracy in all these numbers, and there's also a degree of unreliability in the statistics, so much so that a committee of our Houses of Parliament, the Regulatory Reform Select Committee, recently said that it doesn't really matter if government only achieves 22% against this 25% target. Let's not get too hung up, they were saying, and I agree with them, let's not get too hung up on the precision of these numbers, because once you start to actually apply a quantitative lens to them, they're not actually that sophisticated. That's not a criticism. It's simply to say, let's not place too much weight on them. But we do focus on some important things in administrative burden reduction. We think more important than the detail of these numbers. The first point is, we are always interested in the real-world interaction between regulator and regulated. And any of you who had the misfortune to hear me already this afternoon will know that I've spoken about that at some length in an earlier session. But there's another really crucial factor which came up in both the Swedish and Danish presentations, which is often missed here. I think you've got to read administrative burden reduction as not only something which is going to help business, but it's also changing the incentives within the public administration's culture. Because in the past, of course, when a government department set about creating a new policy or a new regulation, there was really very little disciplining or consciousness of the cost side of the equation that was being imposed outwards. So we think that the great benefit of the standard cost model, its tremendous positive advantage, is that it can concentrate the mind of officials in departments and make them think about the results of what they're doing in a way that I don't think they would absent this kind of structure. And I think there's another point here, which is that by having these numbers, rules of thumb though they may be, unreliable in crude statistical terms, pure statistical terms, they still have one very important benefit, which is they direct the attention of a government department to those areas that may be ripe for simplification. They act as a guide. So our second inversion is, we are not auditors whose eyes light up. When we see all of these numbers, we think about what they're trying to achieve, and that's what we focused on. My third inversion is to think about what we're trying to achieve with all of these measures. And it's an inversion which I think seeks to get away from the very word burden itself. I believe that we shouldn't really be talking too much about burdens. I think we should be talking about making happy companies. Now, that's a phrase which I picked up from one of the earlier presentations. I think it's a powerful and important phrase that we ought to spend a bit of time thinking about. What do I mean by happy companies? And why should I want to have that as a goal? You might say companies will never be happy. You might say that it's a ridiculous thing to say because companies will always complain. I think there may be something in that, but that's not really a fatal objection to any government policy. And we have all sorts of policies which have impossible targets, like reducing inequality. We know that inequality is a part and parcel of the way economies function. We still set the goal to reduce inequality. Similarly, improving health cannot be an absolute target. So I suppose what I'm saying is maybe happier companies. Can we create happier companies? And why is this important? Firstly, I think because happier companies are much more inclined to take the risk to invest in new projects. They trust the system that regulates them. They understand the requirements they face. They have confidence about the certainty of the regime. And I think that leads to the very great possibility of them taking the risk for new investments. That's very important. I also think that if we can make companies happier by making it easier for them to comply, we actually make it easier to enforce regulation. The simpler the regulation, the easier it is to comply, but also the easier it is to enforce. And that has a knock-on effect on the public sector side, which I think is very important. And a third reason why I think happier companies really are significant and important is something that I have mentioned in the earlier session. So again, apologies to those of you who've heard this already. I think companies and the public sector, regulated and regulators, are engaged in the co-production of benefit. I give the example of a nursing home, which might be providing care to an elderly person. Of course, there are regulations guiding the way that care is delivered, but actually, the regulations aren't really delivering the benefit. It's the provider itself, guided, constrained, enabled by the regulations. And I think that if you have a set of regulations that companies are happy with, understand, appreciate, and want to comply with, you're much more likely to align the incentives between the public goal and the private provision. So I think that this co-production point is really quite significant and another reason to want to target happier companies. So when we've done our audit work, we have, of course, done the things you'd expect of auditors. We've checked some numbers and we've focused very rigorously on the processes which government departments have in place to deliver and to quantify the savings they've achieved. But we also appreciate a much broader perspective, which is this goal that we think is to change the incentives within the public sector and also to create happier companies. And we've gone a stage further. We've looked at all the surveys that there are out there of business perception, and we've really taken a lot from them, but we've realized that they don't quite answer the question that we want to answer, which I've summarized in a nutshell as happier companies. So we've commissioned an annual survey of 2,000 companies, which is actually quite a large survey by these standards, to track perceptions. The numbers in any one year aren't as interesting as the trend in numbers over time. And without wishing to tell you so much that you won't need to download our report from our website, I'll just give you a sneak preview, which is essentially the numbers do appear very gently and very gradually to be moving in a positive direction. I'm not confident to say that this administrative burdens reduction program is working, but neither could I say actually things are getting worse. It could be that we're seeing some light just on the fringe of the horizon as the sun's beginning to come up. Let me close by proposing a fourth inversion, however. I realize that I'm sharing a platform with some representatives of business organizations, and I suppose that many of you here too may be business organizations. And I'd like you to do an inversion. I'd like you to ask the question, not what can we do to tell government how awful they're being to us, but do the inversion to say, well, as businesses, what burdens do we impose on government? In what ways do we make government's life hard? And in what ways can we make happier administrators? That's all. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, I will be kind enough to have pose a question to you.
Yes. Will it make me happy?
Yeah, I hope so. I think you can answer, actually. I know you have talking a lot about the incentives and what's important for better regulation work and auditing. I know you have surveyed, I think, 2,000 companies or business people 2 years in a row, and what were they telling you? That's my first question.
Yeah.
Another one is that I know you also looked into impact assessment. I think it's some governmental civil servants here, and I would like to know what's your opinion, what will improve the impact assessments due to your auditing there?
Well, can I take the second question first? Because in a way it's quite nice to focus on the flow of new regulations before we start to think about what we do with the stock of existing regulations. What will make impact assessments more effective? I think there's lots of focus on the techniques of cost-benefit analysis, and there's also lots of focus on, from me, I say this a lot, about the need to consider the compliance aspects. How will this new bit of regulation play out in the real world? Who will collect the bits of paper? What forms will need to be filled in? That's all important. I think there's another thing which is often missed and really crucial here, which is that I think impact assessments have got to be used meaningfully in advocacy and debate, particularly in the parliament. After all, impact assessments are designed to accompany legislation, to enable our elected representatives to scrutinise legislation better. And I think that that there's evidence in our country that Parliament is beginning to do that, but I think a lot more would really help, because I think that if there's one incentive which is really powerful on public administrators, on civil servants, it's the need to provide good material which is going to go out into the public domain. It's that kind of scrutiny which will make people take this work more seriously. All the other stuff, the technical stuff, the training, the governance, all of that I think would flow if actually at the highest level these things were really focused on a bit more than they are. So I think that would be my plea. And actually we are working with the Regulatory Reform Select Committee in our parliaments to see if there are ways that we can make more of that. But that's what I'd say. On your first question, which is what is our survey telling us, I think, I could go through all the results. Can I just pick out two sets of findings?
Yeah.
First is that there is a small positive shift in the business perception of regulations. For example, there's a shift from a negative perception that regulation is not fair and proportionate to a slight shift into the positive that businesses are saying we actually believe regulation is more fair and more proportionate. Now it's a very subtle shift, but it's going in the right direction. And accompanied with some other evidence in our survey, it gives us just a little bit of confidence. The other thing, however, is how much of what irritates business is not pure burden. It's things like regular change. And it's also things like, where do we go on your website? Navigating your website isn't very clear. That's not directly picked up in burden measurement exercises, but it is an important factor which creates unhappier companies. And we've got the survey evidence which demonstrates that. So one of the things that we really emphasize, just to answer your question, therefore, is that the Better Regulation Executive, which is the UK government institution delivering this, is right to focus on communication, because actually it's communicating the framework of changes and the framework of requirements, which is just as important as the actual simplifications themselves. So that's really the direction that our evidence is pointing. Of course, there's a lot more detail, and www.nao.gov.uk. Please go there. You can download it. It's a great report. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And now it's you're free to have questions now. We have a little bit more than half an hour, you can pose question now. Of course, you can post it on the whiteboard over there, and we'll take it over to the next building, and you can have it later on. But what do you say about what you have heard? Is this fine, or do you have any questions? Will you do that now in your country? Please.
Ulrich Neuwirth, Commission for an Efficient Administration, Germany. We have a phenomenon in Germany which is called fat bureaucracy, i.e. it's not the financial burden of the information, but the way people have to deal with it is important. And the second thing is people are upset because of being asked several times. Very often this information duty is that much in size of the financial costs, but it really gets on our nerves, on the nerves of firms at least. Mm-hmm. Is there a phenomenon in Denmark, Sweden, and Great Britain which is comparable? Thank you.
Thank you for the question, and please.
Well, yes, I tried to address it a little bit, that that these are really the factors that are annoying businesses, and sometimes we also have to reduce the things that are that costly, because they just seem a bit stupid sometimes. Like, as you said, asking the same information twice from different agencies. I mean, what's the point? We live in a modern society with a vast potential for information distribution. Why can't the government distribute this information in their own ranks. And here we are also looking a bit to the experience of Norway, as Annika mentioned, that they have made a central register of all the data the government receives and make sure that you can't ask for something that somebody else already have. And that should be, well, self-evident. And also we are looking a little bit about making inspections more service-minded, also having the whole regulatory process going on in a better atmosphere, as I think also Ed is pointing a little bit. How can we make the administrators more happy, and how can we make the companies more happy? Well, it's all about making better communication and making a better atmosphere where, and also, as I said earlier, having an efficient division of labor where you can actually see the point of what you're doing yourself and the point of what everybody else are doing. So I think this is something we're also working a lot on in Denmark, and hopefully we'll get there.
I would also say that it has to be also more cooperation between the agencies at national level, and more cooperation between member states also, rather than imposing new obligations or more frequent reporting on business, the cooperation. For instance, in the VAT area, the cooperation between the member states should be improved first, rather than shortening the time between reports. And that is going to be very annoying if it is implemented.
Thank you. Any more questions? Yes, please. Two.
Damien Nussbaum from the Better Regulation Executive in the UK. I was very struck by some of the comments that you were making, Ed, about business irritation and how that's not necessarily exactly the same thing as administrative burden reductions. It's often said that what's measured is what gets done, and at the moment we're putting a lot of work into measuring burdens. We have 25% reduction targets, and I think that's incredibly important, and you know, something that we want to push through at UK level and EU level. But there's a really interesting question about irritants. And if it is true that what you measure is what can get done, perhaps you may or may not agree with that, but should we be measuring irritants and in order to prioritize what we can change, what needs to be done most quickly? And if so, how?
Well, I'm not sure how many of you picked up the phrase, but the phrase is what measured, what gets done. I don't quite know the derivation of the phrase, but I can tell you who I heard say it most often, which is Sir David Arculus, who was a British businessman who then went to run our Better Regulation Task Force, and that's the organisation which first recommended the adoption of the Dutch model, of the standard cost model. So when you say what's measured, what gets done, in fact, it's that philosophy which has absolutely underpinned the creation of the standard cost model or its adoption in the United Kingdom. I think I would be a very strong advocate of government departments and government agencies thinking very much about the irritation factors. I think it's been implicit in everything that I've said, and let me make it explicit. I think there are things that can be assessed and evaluated by departments. What I think I'd be a little bit skeptical about, if I'm honest, is the idea that this can be done at a horizontal macro level across all government, so that to match the standard cost model for burdens, we have the standard cost model for irritations, and everybody would go out and do a second huge measurement exercise, and then we have some metric to reduce irritations by X percent. I actually don't think that would be a very intelligent way of going about it. I think it's much more that actually each government department and its agency kind of deals with a specific domain. It might be the domain of companies involved within environmental discharges, or it might be the domain of shops, if you're a trading standards officer, and so on. And I think actually it's for those people responsible for the little sub-communities within the whole business world, for them to understand the dynamics and drivers of what irritates, and to adopt that as their goal. I think if you start to do it at the macro level, I just fear that you'd probably end up with all sorts of spurious targets, which which may cost more to design than they would achieve by implementation.
Thank you. And Jesper from Danish industry, what do you think?
I actually agree that I don't think we should measure this because, I mean, it's hard to measure the degree of irritation, and it's also very dependent on what you got irritated over last. So I don't think we should do that. But there are some things we can do. We can actually start listening to the businesses. We've talked a lot to our members about irritation factors, also things that are not very costly administrative, but that we can... that we could reduce, so it's also a bit starting to listening to what the companies are actually saying. I have some statistical measures where they have to report their stock of wood in 5 different categories, and I mean, these things must be simplified. I mean, why do we need so detailed information? I can't see the point, and the companies can't see the point either. So you start listening to a bit of their experiences of what they actually find annoying. And as I stressed earlier, that if you actually start making regulation more logical, I think that you would reduce the irritation as well. So I think you can actually obtain both targets, both reducing the cost burdens and the irritation burdens in the same process.
Mm. I would agree also on that, because I think it could also be included in the consultation process. At least in Sweden, we don't limit ourselves to merely discussing the proposal if it also implies other irritations to business, then we of course make sure that the government is informed of this. So I think it can be done in a slightly different matter than by measuring it, because I also think that it would be very hard. It depends on whether or not you slept well that night, if you are irritated, if it's a great irritant or if it's a slightly less irritant.
Thank you very much. Please.
Alexander Avon from the Institute of Directors. I just had a couple of quick questions. First, one reflection. The Institute did some research amongst our members, which isn't yet in the public domain, and what we found was that 70% of members recognised a specific incoming piece of legislation, whether or not it affected their business, but only about 30 to 50% of members noticed simplification measures, so improvements. So on that basis, it clearly means that either there needs to be greater effort put towards communicating the improvements, or in fact, there needs to be greater scale of improvements. I just wondered what the panel's reflection was on that. The second point I just briefly wanted to raise was, from the Institute's point of view, the 25% reduction is of itself a measure to get to a better place in terms of happier businesses, as Ed called them. And perception's really the game that we're in here. Should there not be a metric or requirement here on business perceptions themselves?
Thank you. Who will start?
I can go if you like. Well, firstly, I'm really interested in those findings about the 70% who recognise new regulation and but only 30% recognising simplification. I think that really enhances the point I was making, that it's really tremendously important in this program of regulatory reform to make sure that you're communicating what's being done in a coherent way to businesses. And it's not actually showing off on the part of government to say, we've introduced this change, this is going to be simpler. In a way, it's actually supporting the business itself by telling them stuff which is going to be useful to them. In terms of should there be a metric, actually I think there is, because I think that the Department for Business and Enterprise and Regulatory Reform has as one of its objectives, its departmental objectives, tracking changes in the perception measures that we ourselves have used. So it is part of their overall performance framework. It's kind of one of many measures, but it is there. I think that I wouldn't want to go any stronger than that, but I think, you know, I wouldn't want more weight to be put on this work than that, but I think that's good that it is part of their overall framework of performance measurement. So,
thank you.
Yeah, communication could really be improved, because, and I think that is very necessary. It's not altogether easy, but that is what needs to be done if the business are to perceive there is an improvement in the system. And before we have this better communication, it's rather difficult to say whether or not we would also require better regulations. So first, we will need definitely more communications.
Well, of course, we should communicate better, and but I think we should also remember that happy companies are not the prime target. They are a very important target that we should address this, but I think my CEO at least would say that we're not looking for happiness, we're looking for growth. And if we can actually make the right conditions for businesses, they might still be annoyed of some regulation and a new regulation, and that's just too bad. We'll never make them entirely happy. But if we give them the right framework to actually do their business and be a little annoyed at the same time, I guess we could live with that as well. That being said, I of course think we should also try to address this other target of making them a bit more happy.
Thank you, Jesper. Please, we have a new question here.
Yeah, not a direct question, sorry. I want to add something about the discussion on irritation before. I'm Daniel Charité, now working for Deloitte, but recently working for the regulatory reform group in the Netherlands. And I was one of the authors of the standard cost model manual in 2004, now 2.0, that we made in the Netherlands. And we strangled with the same questions about how to, well, measure irritation, because you can't really measure it and it doesn't really add something to it. So what we did is, the standard cost model, it gives you focus because it quantifies and it gives you the because you know where the main amount of burdens are, it gives you focus. So what we wanted to do is, well, if you know where to focus, where do you have to focus on? So we added seven statements. Those seven statements were coming from, well, the part within standard cost model where you can, what we call turn on. So you can lower the frequency, you can make it easier, so maybe someone cheaper can do it within the organization, that kind of statement. So we asked for each on information obligations, besides we asked how much time it costs, we also asked, do you understand why the government asked this from you? Because if businesses don't understand why the government asked it, it's almost always a big irritation. We asked them, the way the government asks it from you, is it the way that you have it in your own organization? Do you have this information already in your own organization, or do you have to make it, do you have to adjust it before you can get it to government? Do you understand or do you agree with the frequency in which the government asks this information of you? Well, that resulted in seven statements, and you can all read them in the new standard cost model that the Netherlands have, that added an extra input on, if you know where to look, you can also see, well, if we are going to simplify in that area, we have to focus on, for example, lowering the frequency or making it easier, or if a business doesn't understand why we ask it, we have to tell them why we ask it and make it clear, or maybe there is no necessity of it, so we can just skip it. So it gives you more focus. So I just want to add it. So maybe irritation isn't measurable, but you can do by adding some qualitative statements, you can get information about irritation, but all at the same time, it gives you focus on how and where to look. So,
thank you very much.
Can I just commend you for that? That's really, a creative and intelligent development of the standard cost model. And to some extent, it reflects the evaluation approach that we've adopted in auditing the achievements of standard cost model 1.0 in the United Kingdom. So I think it's really positive to see those things being developed, and I hope that we can pick them up in the UK.
Yes, please. One there and then the second one there, please.
To give out qualified proposals for administrative burden reduction, and it's also something that Mr. Fries has picked up on in his topic, saying that it's also the responsibility of the business. But then, being from a public institution, I would perhaps like to ask a really concrete thing. What can we as a public institution do better in order to help small and medium enterprises to present a better quality proposals for us? Is it whether we need to write some type of guidelines, or is the problem in the way we ask for the input from the small and medium enterprises? Maybe it's not sufficiently clear, and maybe we need some explanations or some checklists for the businesses so they would be better prepared to help us. Thank you.
Thank you for that.
I think what I meant with that the government must be the driving force is, of course, in the regulatory process. The business organizations need to propose things and point in what is the problem, what do business perceive as their problems. But in order to really put it on the map, put it on the agenda for the legislation process, that needs to be done in the government. But I think it's very important to learn from good examples or best examples in other member states, also within the EU and outside the EU, because a lot of things can be gained by actually having communication and cooperation between agencies and business organizations. We have a lot of informal consultations also with the agencies in Sweden, for instance, and they consult with us on their guidelines and on also sometimes on their information type or their way of presenting information. So it's really, the field is open. And I think it's much easier for government agencies to cooperate with business organizations, because we can sort of sum up a lot of business interests rather than having one business say this and another say that. So normally we have several business organizations present or coming in different turns to the agencies. And I think that is a very good idea for better presentations. And the tax authorities in Sweden have really started working in that direction very much. And this has improved the system very, very much.
As I understand your question, you want more concrete proposals from SMEs. And I also think you're asking a lot of a small enterprise, because, as I said earlier, if you want to make really good regulation, you have to really understand the whole process, both on your side, on the other side. And you can't expect a small enterprise to actually know what they are, their obligations, what purpose they are fulfilling, what legislation we're talking about. You're asking some really complex questions out of them. So what you can do is try to understand what they're saying, but they won't say a specific, you have to do so and so, because they won't know whether you should change the legislation, but you can understand their problems. And maybe the government themselves or through business organizations, we can find a better solution when we are sitting looking at the, what you say, the bigger picture. I don't think you can expect that concrete proposals from an SME.
Can I just add one very, I agree with all of those comments, one sort of practical suggestion, and I'm afraid I don't know how your government issues consultation documents, but I sometimes think that one of the reasons it's hard for smaller organisations to respond to consultation is that the consultation document is structured in our country, in the United Kingdom, in a very professional way, a very structured way, with paragraphs of explanatory text and then detailed question, paragraph of text, detailed question. And what you find is that big companies have regulatory departments who know how to handle that material. They've got the time, the mental time, and the practical experience in pulling together their answers in a way which is coherent underneath the questions laid out by the consultation document. I'm not so sure whether smaller enterprises, which maybe don't have regulatory departments, have the capacity to respond to such well-structured consultations. So this is maybe another inversion. Maybe consultation documents could be less well-structured. Maybe that would be a way of helping. I do think there's something about the way the documents are structured in the United Kingdom which might actually just not even
communicate poorly to small enterprises, just completely miss the point, because small enterprises just will not engage in that way.
Thank you. Just a small comment here. Then we have one more question there, and one there, and the last one over there. Thank you.
Okay, just very shortly to say, consultations should be, of course, in the written procedure, which is perhaps very professional, but it can also be in meetings with business organizations. And that was more my intention. Discussions or informal consultations of other kinds. And I would also suggest perhaps having cooperations between the authorities in Lithuania and other members, other tax authorities in the different member states. How do you go about this? Because then you can perhaps have their input on what works in our country. It might work with you, or you could shift it in some other direction, perhaps. So both informal and the formal consultations are equally important.
Thank you for that. Please.
Thank you very much. Kirsten Scholl from the Federal Ministry of Economic Affairs here in Berlin. Just take the opportunity to address Ms. Fritsch in her as a member of the Stoiber Group. We asked for what the business want from regulatory reform, and I think the proposals from the Stoiber Group, they are quite very good part for this, and you presented some proposals for the on company law, and now just one very concrete question on the proposals on the smallest enterprises, which you presented in July this year, and now you asked for the driving force, and the next driving force to put them into practice is now then up to the Commission. And I know that Commissioner McCreevy was quite, in the beginning, perhaps more hesitant, now more open to it, but still we have to wait as a member state that the Commission might present this proposal you made in July this year. Do you think there's any chance perhaps to have it before summer next year? Perhaps you might not be the right addressee for this question, but perhaps you have some glance or some hint for this. Thank you.
The issue has actually left the Stoiber Group. Once we have presented our opinion, then we are not involved in the future process. We may get reports on what is happening, but we are not involved in the process once we have delivered our advisory opinion to the Commission. So I have no idea if it is going to be implemented or not.
Please.
So hi, my name is Neil Tesse from the German Federation of German Industries. I want to answer to your question, maybe what we think you can do more to involve the business in the process is maybe mixed committees. In Germany, we had involved a lot of business people in the measurement, but not so much in the real work to come up with proposals for reduction proposals. So I think it's a really good idea to get the people from the business really in the working groups within the ministries to come up with concrete ideas. And it's not enough to write them emails or something that they should come up with the ideas. They really have to get the feeling they want to done something, and they need my knowledge. And I think when they get this feeling, they are happy to get involved also in the process of getting good ideas to reduce administrative burden. Thanks.
Thank you.
I have just one comment on that. Mm-hmm. That's a very good idea, and we've done it a little bit in Denmark as well, but then they also need some feedback afterwards. What proposals are they taking up, and what are they doing, and some explanation why the proposals they might think are very sound are not being handled. So it's a responsibility the other way around as well.
Yeah. Last question, and then we sum up.
Thank you. Susanna Divicentonio from the Institute of Chartered Accountants in England and Wales. We are a professional body with over 130,000 members in 160 countries, and the day is drawing to a close, and I hope you won't mind if I try and set the cat amongst the pigeons at the very end. I agree with very much of what has been said, and in particular the points about what gets measured gets done. But I think my question is, are we actually being ambitious enough for business? And we've talked a lot about surveys this afternoon, and The Institute has also done its own survey. We do a survey every year of our members in the UK working in business and ask them how things are going, and we don't see actually a great improvement. But this year, more interestingly, we asked our members who are outside of the UK, our members in the EU and our members in Southeast Asia and in the US, and we asked them a very simple question. We asked them, how business friendly do you think your government, your regulatory environment is? And I don't think it will surprise you if I tell you that two-thirds of our members in Southeast Asia and the US said they thought they were in a sort of very business friendly environment, and well under half in the UK and in Europe said that. So I think my question to the panel is, are we actually being ambitious enough for business? Thank you.
Thank you very much for that.
Well, I really should declare a conflict of interest here. Insofar as I am one of those 130,000 members of Susanna's Institute, so I can't really... I mean, everything that my Institute produces on my behalf is really excellent work, and I commend you for it.
okay, don't say anything. Please.
Are we being ambitious enough? We can always be better. And we should never sit back and say, oh, let's be content with what we have achieved, but we should always try to be a little bit better than what we have achieved, I think. So we must keep it up, and we must continue to be committed to it, because we must realize that it doesn't end by 25% reduction if our respective governments will meet their targets. It doesn't end there, because then, of course, we need to address the total regulatory burden, which hasn't been done very much yet. So it is a continued process. So I cannot say we are not ambitious enough now, because we should look at the total regulatory burden, and we will not be ambitious enough if we or our governments will meet the 25% target. We have to keep up to continue.
Well, I think there's a lot of ambitions going on. I don't know if they're enough. I think the EU set a very ambitious target by reducing their burdens by 25% in 2012. Now, I visited you in the UK like 2 weeks ago, and in Britain I know they're working on a new concept of regulatory budgets, which also seemed very ambitious. There's talk of measuring compliance costs. There's a lot of programs going on at the moment, so I think there is a lot of ambitions. Now we just need to see them be fulfilled. And I also think we have to watch out that we're not piling too much on these poor civil servants. I'm almost saying that we can't get any of the initial targets done. But that being said, when our targets are in place and the processes are running, of course we're going to have to look if we can improve that.
Thank you. Before you leave, I make some short concluding remark and then some practical information I got from Bertelsmann Foundation, so you have to wait for that as well. But first, you have heard a lot now about the toolbox and the impact assessment, how to get a better impact assessment. One thing that was really stressed today was, of course, stakeholder consultations. We talked about happier and growing companies, but also to get happy business organizations, I think if you contact them, invite them both, you will have better impact assessments, I'm sure, and also they could help you with the constructive work on simplification work as well. So that's a tip from the panel here. And perhaps. And another thing that's very important is the communication, of course. You have to communicate so you have the right expectations during the work of better regulation. I think if you go out and say, now we should have a better regulation agenda and we will cut 25% of the administrative costs, the business people, they hear, cut 25% of my costs. And there's something totally different, because you include all the cost of financial costs and things like that. So that's why it's very important to be clear with the communication during the work. And at the same time, sometimes you decide for new regulation, but the business have to wait 2 years before it will come into force. so they won't feel it in 2 years. And that's something else that's a very important connecting to communication, that you have the right expectations. We have talked about evaluation also, and you have heard from Ed here that from National Audit Office they are doing that, and you also heard from the floor that other organizations, private and governmental organizations, are working on this. This is very important. And we heard from the other session from Australia that they're also doing that after 2 years' time, review the regulations. And as a civil servant, perhaps that's a problem. I've done my work, I've done my best, and now they're going through it again. But I think it's very important because you don't know. Everything changes, and if we want to have a regulation that are accepted by people or businessmen or others, you have to update also the regulations so they could be committed to follow that, and you have a better compliance. So before that, how quick are you?
I'm very quick. I just wanted to say one final thing, which is that I've said that this afternoon we should set ourselves the goal of happier companies, also of happier administrators, and we've heard about the need for happier business organizations. You may wonder why I haven't mentioned happier auditors. Well, let's just stick to what's realistic.
Thank you. And before you leave, I would like to actually invite you all to Stockholm next year. My organization, together with the Swedish government, together with the Bertelsmann Foundation, I think you heard it 3 times now, but anyway, next year, 12th to 13th of November, we will arrange this conference in Stockholm. So you're all invited, and I hope to see you there as well. And before you leave, I got the information that after this session, it's something called Your Space in the building next door. Continue to have discussions and information shared. And at the buses are leaving in 15 minutes outside here if you're not taking a walk to your hotel. And of course, you know about receptions and dinner, I believe. Thank you very much, and see you later. Thank you.